So my course is called Algorithms for High-Dimensional Data, and let me start with a super short introduction on what it is about and why should we care about it. So the usual way high-dimensional data even shows up is by the following idea. So basically, you usually start with some data set of some objects, let's say tweets, and then for whatever reason, we're interested in understanding relationship between them. There are many ways to do it, but one standard way is to take a tweet and compute a feature vector out of it. So for example, one simple construction that you can use is called bag of words. So what is a bag of words? You basically have a coordinate for every word, for every possible word, and the value of a given coordinate is just how many times this word occurs in a tweet or in any other text document. And this allows you to stop thinking about tweets or texts and start thinking about feature vectors in a vector space, and this vector space is usually called feature space, and you can do various things with them. So for instance, if you would like to understand how similar two tweets are, you can take a look at two corresponding vectors and just compute angle between them, and this would be your similarity measure. And overall, overall, the idea is you start with some data analysis task, and through some transformation, like bag of words or something like this, you arrive to some geometric problem that you would hope to solve. And what one good example here might be find a cluster of similar text documents. So if you think what this problem means in the feature space, this is just like find a bunch of points or bunch of vectors that are close to each other. So it's purely geometric problem at this point. So this is great. However, there are a couple of challenges here. And both of these challenges have to do with scale. One is slightly more obvious, one is slightly less obvious. So slightly more obvious, I don't understand what's going on with PowerPoint, actually. Why it starts pushing the button by itself. One second. This should be, hopefully this should be better now. Yeah, so basically, okay, so first issue slightly more obvious is that usually data sets that we have to deal with are very large. So for example, Twitter each year gets around 200 billion tweets. So if we hope to do something meaningful with data sets of this sort, our algorithms should be extremely efficient. But one slightly less obvious issue, and this will be essentially focus of my course and specifically today's talk as well, is high dimensionality of the data that you have to deal with. So for example, if we have bag of words representation, we have one coordinate for every English or Russian word, and we can easily end up with having vectors of 100,000 dimensions or maybe more. And overall, we can label the data we have to deal with as like massive high-dimensional geometric data. And let me just point out that in the example I showed you, 100,000, it's obviously like high dimensions. But even if you have like at least 100 dimensions, this already can be classified as high. So pretty much like any meaningful feature representation usually gives you high-dimensional data set. And it is precisely this issue of high-dimensionality that disqualifies a number of approaches to problems like this. So namely, there is a whole field that, like classical, very well understood, field with lots of important applications that originates in the 60s. It's called computational geometry. And typically, algorithms there, their complexity depends exponentially on the dimension. So it works really well for two, three, maybe four dimensions, but it doesn't really scale that well beyond that. And this phenomenon even has a name, so this is called curse of dimensionality. You might have seen it, but basically the idea is like for many problems, or for at least like for some non-trivial problems, if dimensionality of your data grows, at some point your problem starts being algorithmically much more difficult. And that's exactly what I hope to cover at least a little bit. Yeah, okay, this is great. And before I proceed to actual content, let me actually make one remark. So usually algorithms for high dimensional data operate through a certain toolbox that is quite small and quite coherent. And one of the hopes would be so that after this course you would have some pretty good idea about all these primitives. And basically you can label them as efficient representations of data, and they include things like randomized hashing, sketching, dimension reduction, metric embeddings, and some other things. And right now let me informally define what sketching is so that we are all on the same page. And let me do it again by an example. Suppose that we have a data set of pictures, for whatever reason we're interested in like all pairs of pictures that are similar to each other. Then one simple way to do, probably the most trivial thing you can do, is just like try all the pairs, and for each pair compare the corresponding two pictures. And imagine that our similarity measure like requires us to compare pictures pixel by pixel. So if your pictures are very high resolutions, high resolution, and you have lots of them, then this procedure would take lots of time. However, sketching in many situations allows you to like basically, given a picture, compute some short binary code, which is called a sketch. And then now instead of comparing pictures, you would compare this like short binary codes. And from these codes, hopefully you would get some pretty good idea how similar the corresponding two pictures are. And this way you can speed things up quite considerably. So again, this is informal definition. We might see sketching later in the course. And moreover, Michael Kapralov, I believe he will cover sketching in much greater detail than I will. So you'll see. At the level I explained it, it doesn't sound like there is difference. Usually when you think of hashing, you think about like collisions, so basically when your codes exactly collide. So when you have sketching, it potentially allows you like more refined estimation procedures. You can compute Hamming distance, you can compute like something else. So it's a technicality, but sometimes it is an important one. Yeah. So in hashing, we usually care about exact collisions. Okay, great. And now, basically, as the previous course, my course will be relatively focused. So basically, I'll concentrate on like 1.5 problems, pretty much. So basically, first thing I'll cover, and this will be, hopefully, we will get to it today, and maybe part of tomorrow's lecture will be about it. It's like dimension reduction. And second problem, it's like nearest neighbor search. So informally speaking, dimension reduction says that, OK, we'll take our data set, but it's like high dimensional. So what can we do to reduce our dimension to still hopefully preserve some useful properties of it? And nearest neighbor search, so basically it's a problem. You have high dimensional data set. You want to preprocess it so that then do similarity search on it. So given a query, just like find similar data items. And this problem is one of the most famous ones that exhibits this curse of dimensionality. And I'll spend a good amount of time like talking about it. And maybe in the end, if we have time, I'll talk a little bit about like fast linear algebra. It has to do a little bit with the previous course, but taking slightly different point of view, which uses some of the technology from the previous slide. But I don't think we will get to it, to be honest. Finally, Michael Kapralov will cover streaming and sketching in a greater detail. And traditionally, these two topics also fall under this like high-dimensional geometry framework. Now, before actually I'll start like talking math, let me say a couple of remarks here. First of all, set of topics is obviously very biased. It's heavily biased towards my PhD research. I'm finishing up my PhD, so I'm like now. Basically, when you do PhD, it requires you to dive very, very deep, and then so you basically become like expert on one problem. So basically, I'll talk about this problem that I'm presumably an expert on. But of course, there is much more material. So if you're interested in like topics like I will talk about, I'll be happy to provide more pointers, books, papers, and whatnot. Another thing that I really like about this area is that usually algorithms are not so bad. They're quite easy to describe, but analysis usually is relatively complicated. But at the same time, because algorithms are not so complicated, you can actually implement them. So most of the algorithms I'm going to talk about are pretty implementable. And in particular, for example, for the nearest neighbor search problem, we wrote a pretty nice library, which you can download and play with if you're curious. So basically, this is not only like theorems with proofs, but sometimes it has pretty neat output as like concrete implementations that work super well, actually. Yeah, so basically this bullet point has to do with the previous one, so not everything I'm going to say has a proof, actually. So sometimes I will be saying like empirical things, so I hope you are fine about it. And another thing is that most of the algorithms here are actually randomized, and that's actually my observation that I don't know how to quantify it, but I really think that majority of the algorithms that show up in like modern algorithms research are actually randomized. And I strongly believe that if you want to do any algorithms research, you should have a very, very, very good like understanding of like probability theory and randomized algorithms. Okay, yeah, and another thing I would like to mention is basically I'll show you some algorithms, I'll show you some theorems, maybe I'll show you even some proofs, but really what you hopefully would get out of it is like basically flavor of modern algorithms research that it, like hopefully you will find it fun. And yeah, basically I really hope my mini course to be interactive, so basically if you have any questions, don't hesitate to stop me and ask me, even if you think it's like something really simple and basic. And there are, of course, lots of cool open problems, and this has to do with what Fyodor said in the beginning. So I like pretty much all of us are here to basically show you like current state of the art of algorithms, and like basically at least like in the case of the content that I'm going to talk about, there is a pretty decent chance to like jump on it and like solve something fun. Okay, yeah, so this is it for the introduction, so now let's turn to something more technical, and before actually talking to algorithms, I would like to spend maybe good part of today's lecture, maybe half of it, maybe a bit more, on something that might look slightly irrelevant, but then you will see that it's actually not the case. Yeah, so basically, this is called measured concentration. And the initial question here is as follows: how should we think about high dimensions? So basically, okay, so someone tells you that like imagine d-dimensional space. So what do you think of it? Like how do you like what how do you think of it? Like, okay, you probably took like linear algebra class, right? So you had to deal with like I don't know 100 dimensional vector spaces. How do you imagine it in your brain? Okay, so when you No.
Well, like series of universes doing something.
Okay, I see. So I personally think, and I think that actually most of you think this way, is just like tuples of numbers. You really don't think of it as like geometric space. You really think about it like pretty much algebraically. And this is exactly the point I would like to make. So actually, if you think about high dimensional spaces, geometric intuition usually ends up being pretty useless. So sometimes it is useful, but very rarely. So what I would like to argue is that actually, like, much more helpful way of thinking about it are probabilistic and analytic, or algebraic in the simple case where you don't have any additional structure. And in particular, the phenomenon that occurs very, very often, and it will be instrumental in the things that I'm going to cover further, is what's called concentration of measure. So has anyone seen it in any form? Or maybe the name, or I don't know, like, heard about it? Yeah? Okay, yeah, so a couple of people, but very few of you, so that's good, actually. I will cover now relatively basic stuff. So what is concentration of measure? And I will not tell you about it in abstract terms. I'll show you one concrete problem. This problem might feel almost like a puzzle, but actually it has a pretty significant connection to what I'm going to show next. So the problem is like this. So take d-dimensional space RD, and the question is how many points you can place in RD so that all pairwise distances, so first version of the problem, all pairwise distances are exactly one, and second version of the problem, all pairwise distances are between 1 minus epsilon and 1 plus epsilon, where epsilon, think of it as like 1 over 100 or something like this. Is the problem clear? Do you know the answer to any of the versions? Yeah, so first problem, the answer is indeed d plus 1. But first, let's start with something simple, two dimensions. So in two dimensions, the answer is clearly 3 for both of the versions, right? So you can clearly can't put more than 3 points at like pairwise distance 1. And even if you perturb this requirement a little bit, it's still clear that more than 3 points you can't really place. So in two dimensions, the answer is simple. But then the question becomes, what happens when d tends to infinity? And indeed, as you said, for the exact case, the answer is d plus 1. And do you know how to prove it?
An upper bound, you
mean? Oh, we will need both, but upper bound or lower bound or anything. Induction?
Have an answer for d minus 1. Can add
no sure, yeah. I mean, sure. So for upper bound, the construction is just regular simplex. So basically, it's like triangle or tetrahedron or a high dimensional generalization of it. It's pretty easy to write down explicit formulas of the coordinates of the vertices of it. So that, like, upper bound is d plus 1. So lower bound is a little bit trickier. So for this, you basically need to write down Gram matrix. So basically, because you know all pairwise lengths, you pretty much know all pairwise dot products of your vectors. And then you just need to prove that basically this like v1 minus v0, v2 minus v0, vt minus v0 are linearly independent. So for this, you take your Gram matrix and just compute its rank. And rank is maximum. So we can't place more than d plus 1 point this way. So basically, exact case is fairly easy. So it took us one slide to go through it. I mean, this is some calculation, but it's not so bad. So you can trust me that it's basically like maybe 15 minutes worth work. But approximate case turns out to be way more interesting. And interesting thing here is that as soon as you relax this constraint just a little bit, you immediately start being able to put exponentially many points in the dimension. So basically, as soon as your epsilon is like small constant, as d tends to infinity, like simplex is extremely far from being optimal. So basically, you can place way more points. And this is really, I think this is a pretty surprising statement by itself. And yeah, it's very counterintuitive. And okay, so even though it might feel like a puzzle, it actually has to do with dimension reduction, and we will see this connection later. So informally speaking, just to fast forward, basically this construction gives you dimension reduction for simplex specifically. Okay, and okay, so how do we prove this? How do we prove that we can place 2 to epsilon squared d points with approximately equal distances? So the big idea here, it is to use the probabilistic method. So what is the probabilistic method? Who have seen it like before? Okay, so basically it's like a very simple at first sight idea, but it's like extremely powerful. And it's like basically if you do combinatorics or discrete geometry or algorithms, basically probabilistic method is your best friend. Usually if you need to come up with some construction, first reflex I have is like to try random construction. So what's the probabilistic method? Basically, if you want to show that some object exists, instead of coming up with it explicitly, you basically use a random object, you take a random object and show that it works with positive probability. So this sounds like almost a triviality, but it's actually like if you start thinking about it, it's a very powerful idea. So it was invented by Paul Erder. He used it to show some bounds on Ramsey graphs, and since then it has been used like everywhere. In fact, there is a whole book called Probabilistic Method, and it's like 300 pages. And this is only scratching the surface, actually. It's like it goes much deeper than that. Okay, so let's try to apply it to our problem. So basically, we want to show that you can place exponentially many points with pairwise almost equal distances. So how do we do this? So let's choose a random set of points from unit sphere. So let's take unit sphere in our space and just choose points at random on it, with the hope that it would work eventually. Okay, so how do we analyze something like this? So how do we show that if you put n points on a unit sphere at random, all pairwise distances would be almost the same? So now we need another very useful tool called union bound. So union bound, it's even more like embarrassingly simple than the probabilistic method. So union bound says that if you have like bunch of events, probability that at least one of the event will happen is at most sum of probabilities that like, so it's like, I don't know, I can even write it. So So that's union bound. So it doesn't look much. It doesn't look like much, but it's actually super useful. So again, like if you do probabilistic method, usually you would use like union bound at least once, maybe twice. But what does it mean in our context? So in our context, it means that we need to understand one fixed pair. So if we want to show that all pairs have roughly the same distance between them, so let's define our event EI to be like pair is bad. So then like left-hand side of the union bound says that there is at least one pair that is bad. And right-hand side would be like sum of probabilities that like given pair is bad. So we just need to understand probability of a given pair to be bad. And hopefully that by union bound, this whole thing will be smaller than one, and then we are done. So how do we show this for one pair? So for one pair, now we come finally to concentration of measure on the sphere. So for one pair, if we want to understand like basically how distance between them looks like, it's enough to consider the case when one of the points is just like 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, because you can always, if you have two random points, you can rotate your sphere so that first point becomes 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and second point would still be random, right? And distance between such y and random x is just like determined by the first coordinate of x, right? So, I mean, yeah. So we pretty much need to understand first coordinate of a random point on a sphere. How does it look like? Okay? So do you agree that that's all that remains to understand? Okay, just we started with the idea that like a random set of points on a sphere should work. Then by union bound, we said that we need to argue only about two points. Then we said that, okay, we can without loss of generality assume that one point is fixed. And now finally, we realize that we just need to understand first coordinate of a random point on the sphere. So,
could you explain the last step once again, why it is enough to focus on x1?
Oh, so what's the distance between x and 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, right? Well, if you know x1, then it will be like unique because you know that it's on the sphere, so sum of squares of the remaining coordinates is blah. I mean, there will be some formula, but at least like, yeah, everything is on the sphere, yeah. Okay, so let's try to understand. And first exercise would be to compute this distribution for sphere in three dimensions and actually get surprised. I will not tell you what the answer is. Like, if you compute it, you'll be shocked, I think. I was shocked when I computed it. So I will start with d equals 4 to not spoil the surprise. So for d equals 4, distribution looks something like this. It actually will be a circle. I mean, we don't care about it, but like it looks somehow reasonable. So let's start increasing the dimension and see what happens. So for five dimensions, it would be a little bit like this, and then we increase dimension, increase. And now we hit 1,000 dimensions, and now our distribution is like this, right? So, okay, so what do we get out of it? We get that if we take a random point on a sphere, first coordinate would be extremely, extremely well concentrated around zero. And actually, width of this window would be around 1/√d. So remember this 1/√d, this will be useful for us like many times later. So basically, like the quantitative statement here would be like 99% of the points on a sphere have first coordinate between minus, I don't know what, like 10/√d to 10/√d, something like this. Yeah, so this is quite surprising. Yeah, and actually this exactly shows us that our construction works. So basically because this like first coordinate is concentrated around zero, so it means that typical two vectors on the sphere are near orthogonal, and near orthogonal means that the distance between them is like around √2. And then actually like, I'll show you how this union bound works in this case, but at least like it should be intuitively clear why this random construction is good enough actually. And okay, so one way of thinking about it is that if we are on the sphere, then almost all the surface of it is concentrated around the fixed equator. So basically, if you take equator of your sphere, almost everything on it is like within a very thin stripe. So this stripe would be of width 1/√d, which tends to zero as d tends to infinity, and basically 99% of action happens there. I mean, this kind of makes sense. And by the way, I forgot to mention, so basically So here I showed you only some plots, but how do you actually, like, how would you compute it rigorously? So there are several answers to this. So one way of seeing it would be to just, like, compute things, like, exactly. So basically you can write down distribution of a first coordinate of a random point on a sphere exactly. It would require a little bit of, like, spherical coordinates, but it's not so bad if you, like, took real analysis or differential geometry or something like this. It will be something called beta distribution. You could actually see how it looks like exactly. If you don't want this, then there is another way, which goes roughly like this. So you know all this, like, folklore results, how to generate random point on a sphere, on a unit sphere in D dimensions. Actually, do you know this or not? So who saw it? How, like, how would you go about, like, generating random point on a sphere?
Generate from a normal distribution as normalized.
Precisely, that's exactly the way. So it's actually a pretty tricky thing. It's not so easy to see that it works, but the solution is to just, like, sample D independent Gaussians or normal distribution according to normal distribution, and then just, like, make sure that it's, like, normalized, so divide by square root of sum of squares. And if you think about this process, it's pretty clear that first coordinate would be pretty much like a Gaussian, because this, like, normalization factor, it is not always constant, but it's pretty close to constant most of the time. So basically it's not hard to see that this bell curve behavior should happen. And we'll see it a bit later, actually. Okay, so if you think about, like, this one equator, it kind of makes sense, right? But then, actually, if you start thinking more about it, it again stops making sense, because this is true about any equator. So, like, take this, like, gray equator, basically everything is there. Take this green equator, it is also there, right? So that's a pretty good illustration that, like, geometric thinking in high dimensions, it might be very misleading. So basically don't trust your geometric intuition, use, like, analysis or probability or whatever else you can. Okay, so now let's return to our problem. So I told you that, like, typical first coordinate of a typical vector is around 1 over square root d. Because we want to apply union bound, and we will take union bound over, like, n square events, we would need to make sure that our probability is, like, 1 minus 1 over 10 n square. So this would blow up things a little bit. So we would get, instead of 1 over square root d, we would get square root of log n over d. And then, in order to make this at most epsilon, it's enough to have at most 2 to epsilon square d points. So that's how we actually prove our statement that you can place 2 to epsilon square d points at, like, near equal distance. So is the, like, structure of the proof clear? At least a little bit. Yeah. Any questions? Okay, I have some doubts, but ask me something.
In the beginning, you said that you take a uniform sphere, yes?
Mm-hmm.
But is the distance going to be equal 1?
No, it will not be 1. It will be square root 2. Yeah. But then you can scale things down and get 1, right? So that's, yeah. Sure, that's a good point. So basically, if you take unit sphere, distance between two random points would be around square root 2. Yeah, okay, good. Again, let me outline a connection with what's going to be next. So basically, how this is related to dimension reduction, for example. So dimension reduction is the following problem. So you have n points in a d-dimensional space, and you would like to map them into d-prime dimensional space, where ideally d-prime would be much smaller than d, so that all pairwise distances are preserved up to some, like, 1 plus minus epsilon factor. So basically you want to reduce dimension but not distort your distances too much. And basically, if you think about it, what our previous result meant, it means that if we start with a regular simplex, so basically suppose that we have d plus 1 point in d dimensions with all pairwise equal distances, we can always map them into as few as, like, log n over epsilon squared dimensions while distorting distances only a little bit. Because we can just, like, okay, say, take our regular simplex, take this construction, which is, like, n random points on the sphere, and just, like, assign each point to each vertex. And this would be the valid dimension reduction for a regular simplex. But this bound log n over epsilon square, it's very important, because actually, as we will see later, there is this, like, very powerful result called Johnson-Linnerstrauss lemma, which says that it's not only true, like it's true not only for simplex, it's true in general. So if you start with like any n points, you can always perform a dimension reduction into log n over epsilon squared dimensions and distort distances only by 1 plus minus epsilon. And basically, idea of the proof of it would be also to use some randomized construction, but in a slightly different way. Again, I personally think that this like concentration of measure on a sphere, it's pretty counterintuitive. I mean, you can do some computation, or you can like, I mean, plot things and see that this is happening, but somehow still it's not fully clear why this is going on. And let me try to explain this using probabilistic language. So there is this another question. So basically, suppose that you have 1,000 fair coins. So basically, each coin is like heads with probability 1/2 and tails with probability 1/2. So and if you toss like 1,000 of them, how many heads you will expect to see? Yeah, so right, expectation would be 500, right? But how often you would deviate much from it? So basically, what's a typical, so for example, if I'll tell you, I tossed 1,000 coins and I saw 700 heads, would you believe me or not? Yes. What about like 800? No. So let's try to understand this. And actually, in this case, nice thing about it that you can write like exact formula. It's like sum of some binomial coefficients, right? And you can try to, I don't know, we will look at some histograms. So for example, for 4 coins, these are the probabilities of outcomes. So basically, it's like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And 0 and 4 are quite a good deal, less likely than, for example, 2. So let's start increasing number of coins and see what happens. So that's what happens for 1,000 coins. So if you actually, if someone would tell you that they saw like 700 heads, you shouldn't believe them. So basically, 700 heads is very unlikely because it will be somewhere, I don't know, maybe here. And basically, with very high probability, number of heads would be d over 2 plus minus square root d, right? And this square root d is exactly the same square root d as we saw on the previous, in the previous case. So it actually has the same nature. And this is a very, very powerful observation. It's a simple formula. It's some binomial coefficients. You can like use some Stirling's approximation and actually write down this like asymptotics exactly if you really fancy. But then, even though it's very simple, it enables like lots of things. So for example, like error correcting codes. I don't know if you have heard of them, but it's basically, you start with a message, you increase its length a little bit so that it becomes resilient to some number of like corrupted bits. And basically, this observation already gives you some error correcting code with pretty good parameters. However, it would not be explicit, which is a big problem for error correcting codes. But if you just care about like existential construction, this is it. And actually, it's much more. So this observation that like things like this concentrate very well, they're extremely useful in like discrete math, combinatorics, and theoretical computer science. Another way of thinking about it, about this example with coins, is let's think of a hypercube. So hypercube, it's like basically a set of strings of like d, 0, 1s, right? And basically, if you think about this concentration result, what it means that we should think of hypercube as this drawing. So basically, on the bottom, in the bottom part, we have like vector of all zeros. There is only one such vector. In the like basically top part, we have like all ones. So it's basically only a single such vector. And it means that really almost all the vectors would have like d over 2 plus minus square root d ones. So basically, they are concentrated in these like middle layers. So basically, this is the right depiction of hypercube, not what you would think otherwise. So this is great. But again, like how should I think about it? Why this happens on the sphere? Why this happens on the hypercube? Like, does it happen anywhere else? So these two settings are special. And in both cases, this has to do with what's called central limit theorem. So who have seen central limit theorem? Okay, who knows how to prove central limit theorem, maybe in some weak form? Okay, yeah, we'll not need the proof, but it's actually good to know the proof. At least the proof I know and I really like, it uses some Fourier analysis and it's really beautiful. So like it's two-line derivation if you know all the machinery. But what central limit theorem tells you is that basically if you have independent random variables with mean zero and variance one, then the average, not average, but like sum of them divided by square root d would converge to normal distribution. And so basically this square root d is precisely the reason why you would get square root d in actually both of the previous settings. And this is a concrete statement. You can actually like formulate it and prove it. The proof of it is not so bad. But then it's actually much more general than that. Like, turns out that in many settings where these assumptions do not hold, we still have this like Gaussian behavior. And basically, okay, so first point is how to understand convergence to n 0, 1, and we need to be slightly careful about it, but let's not worry about it for now. But what we should worry about is that lots of work has been put to how to relax assumptions of this theorem properly. So for example, people studied a lot how to like basically get this like Gaussian behavior when your variables are not fully independent, but they're like sort of independent. Or another way to weaken it is to say that, okay, not only it converges to Gaussian when d tends to infinity, but it would be close enough to Gaussian when d is actually something finite. And this later setup is like extremely useful for us because like we don't care about like asymptotics usually. Okay, we do care about asymptotics, but we don't care about like eventually converges with some speed. We usually want to say that after, I don't know, like 1,000 steps, basically our distribution is like that close to a Gaussian in a certain formal way. So basically, statements of the second sort would be extremely useful for us, and we will see many of them being used later. Okay, and now let me tell you, just like now that I'm at it, let me mention a couple of more things that are a little bit out of scope of this class, but I think they're like really nice. So first is isoperimetric inequality. So basically, the most basic isoperimetric inequality you would think is, okay, take like two-dimensional or three-dimensional space and find a shape of volume one that has minimum surface or minimum like perimeter on the plane. So you know what the answer is for this? Sphere, like ball or circle, right? By the way, proving it is actually surprisingly tricky. So if you try to come up with like rigorous proof of it, it's actually not easy at all. And the same is true in D dimensions. So basically, if you want like shape of volume one that minimizes surface measure, it would be again the ball. It's kind of intuitive, but proving it is pretty tricky. But let's see what happens if you live on a unit sphere. So what would be the right problem here? So the right problem would be like this. So we will take our set, initial set A, and we would require that it has given measure. So basically probability that random point lands in A is fixed. For example, it's like, I don't know, 1/3. And then we would consider, so we would say that, okay, surface of it should be as small as possible. But surface is a pretty bad thing. It requires statements about like smooth structure and something like this. So let's not worry about it. Instead of worrying about surface, let's worry about measure of neighborhood of our set. So basically we will consider set of points that are at distance epsilon from our set. And let's try to minimize measure of this like A epsilon. And then the answer turns out to be a measure of A epsilon is minimized if and only if your A is actually a spherical cap of a given measure. And that's the statement now. Is it clear? Why is it so? It's actually like, again, a pretty non-trivial proof. It's actually much more complicated than in RD. But I think at least geometrically it should make sense. So basically if you want to like package your measure in the most economical way, of course you should need to take some blob that kind of looks round enough, right? And this was proved by Levy, and again, this is an extremely useful statement. It's like used in high-dimensional geometry like in many cases actually. And in algorithms too for that matter. And now let's combine our expertise in understanding like concentration of measure on the sphere and isoperimetric inequality, and we will obtain like something completely mind-blowing in my opinion. So basically, the statement we would get is like this. So let's take any set on the sphere that has measure 1/2. So for example, this set could be like half of the sphere, or it could be anything else. So basically, start with any set such that half of the points belong to it. And then let's try to understand how many points would be within distance epsilon of it. Okay, so how to understand this? Okay, so first of all, to minimize this size of A epsilon, we need to take spherical cap. So spherical cap of size 1/2 would just be half of the sphere. And for this half of the sphere, we know that almost all points are within like very, very small distance of it. So basically, if you think what it means, we get that if you start with a set of measure 1/2, if you move from it by like 0.01 or something like this, you would cover almost all the sphere in terms of like measure. So measure of this set would be exponentially close to 1, actually.
How it works for d equal to 1?
Well, for d equal to 1, I mean, it's for small d, it's not very interesting. I mean, you, what you would get for d equals 2, for example, you would have a circle, and then the best set would be like half a circle, and then things at distance 0.1 would be just like a little bit more. And that's exactly, like, this is inherently high-dimensional phenomenon. So basically, in two dimensions, nothing like this happened. You would cover only a little bit more than half in this case. It would be half plus, I don't know, 0.2 or something like this. But then if you start like tending d to infinity, basically these points, so measure of this part would be like closer and closer to 0. It would be like negligible. Everything would be like around here. I don't know, if you are not shocked, it's...
Is there a threshold value where the things explode?
Oh, no, no, it's like, it's a smooth phenomenon, so you just like, things explode gradually, so there is no threshold, it's like... Basically, okay, again, as I said, this like basic, basically width of this like interesting region is around 1 over square root d. So as soon as you get out of this region, you essentially covered everything, almost. Yeah, and basically this is just like corollary of like one simple calculation that I didn't do, but it's really simple. And this has a perimetric inequality, which is like a little bit difficult to prove, but I think it's like geometrically pretty intuitive. I mean, at least like if I had to guess the answer, it would be pretty clear that that's the answer. Okay, and finally, one more corollary of this like last statement is like concentration. Yeah.
Could you please repeat? So. Okay, could you please make this statement more formal? If you make epsilon greater than 1 over square root of d,
yeah,
then, let me just try it.
So then this quantity would be some constant close to 1.9, for example. So if you make epsilon to be like constant over square root d, you would get 0.99 here.
Then a epsilon will cover everything.
Yeah, yeah. And by cover everything, I mean in terms of measure, uniform measure of the sphere.
If you take epsilon 0, still somehow.
No, if you take epsilon 0, it would be 1 minus 1, right? So 0. It's a trivial estimate.
Oh,
yeah. So epsilon 0 gives you nothing. So and usually, like, the setup is always like this. So you have some interplay between like distance and measure. So here, distance is like Euclidean distance induced by ambient space, and measure is just uniform measure. And basically this like measure concentration results, they all have this like delicate interplay between distance and measure. Okay, and now finally let's derive one more corollary, which I think is even more surprising. And so this has to do with something called Lipschitz functions that Alexander mentioned in his lectures, though I'm not sure if he named them like this. But basically Lipschitz function is something that doesn't change much if you move your argument a little bit. So basically, difference between f of x and f of y is upper bounded by distance between x and y. So the statement here would be, if you have on a sphere a function that is Lipschitz, then it's always, no matter what function it is, it's always sharply concentrated around the median. And to see this, it's actually a simple corollary of what I showed you on the previous slide. So let's take a set of points such that function is at most median. Then by the definition of median, measure of it is 1/2, right? So there is no more to it. But then, if you want to deviate from median by epsilon, it means that your x should move from this set by at least epsilon, by Lipschitz property. So if you have this, just like use lemma from the previous slide, and get that basically probability of it is like exponentially small. So that's it. Yeah, so basically that's all I have to say about concentration of measure. This is really only scratching the surface, but just like one concrete, so to say, philosophical outcome of it is that measure concentrates often because, roughly speaking, of something related to central limit theorem. And central limit theorem roughly says that if you have reasonable random variables that are not too dependent, and if you sum them up, this would very quickly converge to a Gaussian, and Gaussians are very sharply concentrated around the expectation. So that's roughly the reason why this all shows up, and somehow this view of on like high-dimensional geometry was not discovered until, I don't know, 60s or 70s actually, when like Vitaly Milman did it, yet another Russian name who is now in Israel. So he basically used considerations like this, in particular Levy's theorem, to prove some geometric statement. Proof of it was known before, but it was like, I don't know, 60 pages of like computations and like some geometric arguments and so on and so forth. He derived like 2-page proof of it using this technology. And then after it, it started being like the standard tool pretty much. And pretty much if you're curious about it, then one very good place to read about it is this like Matoushek's book, Lectures on Discrete Geometry. Then there is a very like wonderful survey of Keith Ball, which covers concentration of measure and actually quite a bit more. It's called An Elementary Introduction to Modern Convex Geometry. I think if you're really serious about like trying to understand things that I'm gonna talk about, you should totally read both of these. And then there are lots of like surveys and very nice papers by Vitaly Milman, who I just mentioned, Talagran, and like some other people. I might mention them offline if you're curious about. And that's it for this like introductory part, and let me actually now start talking about dimension reduction in the remaining 15 minutes. We will not cover it today, the whole thing, but we will start. So dimension reduction. So basically motivation is pretty obvious. So if you have some high dimensional data, imagine that we have something lying in million dimensions, then we would hope to compress it while not losing much. And this notion of not losing much really depends on your application. And basically there are many ways to do it. And some of these ways, you can prove something about them. Some of them are purely empirical. Some things are something in between. And we will see some instantiations of this idea in this course. And let me try to formulate the problem in a formal way. So basically we have n points in RD. We'll denote them by x. And then what I would like is to basically reduce my dimension. So what does it mean? It means that I would like to take my data set and map it into m-dimensional space, where m would be much smaller than d, while preserving pairwise Euclidean distances up to multiplicative 1 plus minus epsilon. So this like preserving pairwise Euclidean distances thing, it's our notion of not losing much. And somehow in many applications, it turns out to be the right thing to do. And formal guarantee that we require is this. So basically distance between f of x1 and f of x2 is within 1 plus minus epsilon from original distance. And in terms of parameters, what we will be looking at is to minimize the target dimension if we are given number of points, initial dimension, and accuracy epsilon. So basically, this is the setup. So is the problem clear? Okay, so.
So in the beginning, you mentioned the problem where we just want to know whether two objects are close to each other or not.
Yeah.
But here, you want actually more than this, right?
So here we kind of hope to preserve distance as a number. So we not only distinguish between close and far, but also we would like to like estimate the original distance. Yeah. And actually, it's a good point that techniques like this could be useful for this example with pictures. So we take our picture, apply dimension reduction, and get much fewer coordinates that are still useful. So if our similarity measure was Euclidean distance, then we are done pretty much. Just do dimension reduction. Or at least we are like done for the purposes of theory. In practice, things are not so nice usually. Yeah?
So how relevant would be the distance that you're using? So if you substitute Euclidean distance for some other thing?
Yeah, distance is extremely relevant. So What I'm going to talk about, it works for Euclidean distance. It doesn't work for anything else. And it's a very good question, when else dimension reduction is possible. We know very little about it. We mostly know negative results. Like, for example, if you have L1 distance, you can still do something, but nothing close to what I'm going to talk about in Euclidean distance. And there are very strong lower bounds. So we know very little. Yeah.
So if I say take a distance L2.1?
Nothing. Actually, we don't know. For L2.1, we don't know any upper bounds or lower bounds, nothing. For like constant, for 1 plus epsilon regime. I mean, you can say that L2.1 distance is sort of close to L2 within some polynomial factor, and then use L2 statement. But that's the best we can do. So it's actually like pretty embarrassing in terms of dimension reduction. So like we basically have lower bound for L1, we have lower bound for, well, for L2 we kind of understand the thing, and then we kind of know very, very little beyond that. Sorry, can you speak up a little bit? Oh, so sorry, I should have mentioned that F is our map. So we basically like map our data set through this map F into RRM. So yeah, basically takes point from X and puts it into like RM. And basically there are like two types of guarantees you can hope here. First of all is like worst case guarantee. The worst case guarantee would say that for like no matter what data set I start, I can always get this many dimensions if I want this accuracy. And data dependent bound would be to say that, okay, maybe for like worst case bounds I can't get, but if my data set is nice enough, then I can do something about it. And what I'm going to talk about for now is like worst case bounds. And then in the end, I'll mention data dependent very briefly. So let's start with something really simple. So basically naive bound. So naive bound would be that you can always reduce your dimension to n minus 1, where n is the number of points. So if you have, I don't know, 10 points in million dimensional space, you can always reduce dimension to 9 by not changing distances at all. And this is an exercise. Actually, it has to do with this like tight example of like regular simplex. It's like relatively simple thing to do. You just need to compute like to take Gram matrix and do something with it. So this already is pretty interesting. So why this is interesting is because this bound that you are getting is completely independent of the original dimension. Original dimension D might be like anything, but you can always assume without loss of generality that it is at most number of points minus 1. So basically, this parameter D ends up being not very relevant, actually. So this bound is tight. So if we want to achieve epsilon equals 0, we can't do better than this. And simplex example shows it, because we can't have like equidistant points more than D plus 1 of them in a D-dimensional space. And it's really, so it's really a Euclidean statement. It's really a statement about like Euclidean distance. For example, statement like this for L1 distance, it's not known to be true. Actually, I think it's known to be false. So for L1 distance, if you want epsilon equals 0, it's like the bound would be much worse, actually. And I guess, OK, so I'll formulate the main result. And maybe, I don't know. Yeah, we'll see. So basically, the main result here is what's called Johnson-Linder-Strauss lemma, which I partially announced in the earlier part of my today's lecture, where when we talked about simplex. And this lemma says something like this. It's called a lemma because it was a lemma in the original paper, but it shouldn't be called like this. It's actually a very fundamental fact. It should be a theorem. So let me briefly remind the parameter setting. So we have data set in RD. We would like to reduce dimension to M, so to 1 plus minus epsilon preserve pairwise Euclidean distances, and the number of points is n. And then Johnson-Linder-Strauss lemma, which I will abbreviate as JL. So JL says that you can always get dimension log n over epsilon square. So no matter what your initial dimension was, you can always compress your points to like log n over epsilon square dimensions. And it actually is very tightly related to this like simplex example. So for simplex, I showed you through this like random construction how to do this, how to get this actually bound. But this theorem says much more. It says that like actually it's true for any set of points, be it simplex or anything else. So then the question is, can we do better? First of all, Alon showed that this is tight up to log 1 over epsilon. And until recently, the hope was that you can actually improve this log 1 over epsilon and to do a little bit better. But in the very recent result, Casper Green Larsen and Jelani Nelson showed that this actually log n over epsilon squared is the best you can do. So there is no way to improve it, which is a bit of a bummer. So basically the proof technique we would be using is again probabilistic method. So we would show that, okay, so we need to show that there is certain mapping. So we will not construct it explicitly as earlier today, but we will instead like take a random object and show that it works. And more specifically, the idea would be to consider what's called a random projection. And as we will see later, Johnson-Linnenstrauss lemma is not actually so useful by itself in practice because of this epsilon square. Epsilon square is usually pretty bad. But this idea of random projections actually is extremely useful. So if anything, you should understand the proof of Johnson-Linnenstrauss to understand and appreciate this notion of a random projection. And let me actually, I guess, explain the construction and maybe the proof I will start explaining tomorrow. We'll see how it goes. So for the construction, we would need the notion of normal distribution or Gaussian distribution, which is just this like bell curve. And we'll need two properties of it. So basically, two properties of Gaussian distribution is that, first of all, it's a spherically symmetrical distribution. So basically, if you take d independent n0 ones, basically, density of this distribution depends only on the distance to zero. It's a simple computation, and it's not very hard to see. And actually, this property characterizes normal distribution. If you would require some distribution such that if you sample AID copies from it, and it's like spherically symmetrical, Gaussian is the only possible way to do it. So it's actually a very fundamental property of it. And then second property we would need is what's called two-stability. So basically, take D, IID, Gaussians, and then combine them with some coefficients. What's the resulting distribution is? So as it turns out, the resulting distribution is again n0, 1 times L2 norm of this vector alpha. So basically square root of sum of squares of alphas. And this will be crucial in the proof, actually.
Should be non-negative for
No. It's actually like for any alphas. It's true. Like it's a very nice property. You can ask the same question, what happens if I want like L1 distance here? Like, can we have such a distribution? The answer is yes, it's called Cauchy distribution. But for example, for L3, it's impossible. So basically, such distributions exist if and only if this like P is between 0 and 2. And it's a pretty non-trivial fact. These are called P-stable distributions. But let's not worry about it, we will need only Gaussians. So are these properties clear? Okay. So, and yes, so that's what we already covered today. So basically, if you take Gaussian vector and normalize it, you will get uniform vector on the sphere. But we will not need this. We will need only these two things. Basically, this has to do with the fact that it's spherically symmetrical. Because it's spherically symmetrical, normalization just gives you a random vector on the sphere. Yeah, and let me say a little bit more about concentration inequalities. So we saw central limit theorem today, and I mentioned that a good amount of work was put into proving finite bounds. So finite bound would be that, like, even if you have some concrete number of random variables, some of them would be close enough to a Gaussian. So for example, one specific inequality of this sort, we will not need it, but it's like a very simple thing to show, is if you have n random plus minus ones, if you sum them up, then probability that you would deviate by more than t square root n is e to minus t square. And this has to do with this like example of 1,000 coins. So if you think what this sum of random plus minus ones means, it's pretty much like how much we deviate from like d over 2 coins, right? And basically this inequality quantifies that we can't deviate really by more than like square root n. Basically, there are lots of statements of this sort, and like it's called like Chernoff inequality, Hövding inequality, Azuma inequality, Hinchin inequality, and there are like way more than that. So we will need some of them today, but you shouldn't worry about it. So basically, if you see some statement of this sort that is plausibly true, it usually ends up being true. It might be a bit difficult to prove, but like somehow usually things go through. So. So now let me finally state how the construction works, and I guess I'll prove it. I'll remind you the construction tomorrow as well, and I'll prove it tomorrow too. But let me just state it. So the construction would be actually like it would give you much more than just this dimension reduction result. And the construction works like this. Let's take our point, represent it as a vector, and then multiply on the left by a random matrix. So this random matrix would have log n over epsilon squared rows, and this will be our new dimension. But entries of A would be random Gaussians. So basically, we will sample entries of A according to this like n01 and hope that it works. And we will show that it indeed works, that like such linear dimension reduction actually goes through. But it actually gives us much more than just dimension reduction for a concrete set of points. It gives us that we actually don't need to know what this set of points is. We can like prepare our map at random, and then basically you would tell me your points, and I'll say, okay, whatever, this map would still work with high probability. And this property is extremely crucial for algorithms. But in our setting, so far we only care about Johnson, Lindenstrauss. And by the way, this proof is by Dasgupta and Gupta. It's not original proof of Johnson and Lindenstrauss. It's technically a little bit simpler. And actually, if you want to understand proof of Johnson, Lindenstrauss, you should read the tech report. It's like very nice. So let's take our matrix A, which would be log n over d dimensional. And entries of it would be independent Gaussians. And then the claim would be that probability that L2 norm of AX is between two quantities that are like within 1 plus minus epsilon of each other and has to do with the norm of X is 1 minus delta. And for this to happen, we need our matrix to have log 1 over delta over epsilon square rows. And if we show this, then we can just use union bound and claim that, okay, it preserves each specific vector. It also preserves each specific difference between vectors because it's a linear map. But then if we set delta to be so small, it would preserve with high probability like all pairs at once. And we crucially use that our map is linear, and that would end the proof. But like I'll show you how to prove this probably tomorrow. And another time we see it today is that A is actually not an explicit map. We don't know how it looks like for any given set of points, but we know that if we sample our matrix, like each entry would be independent Gaussian, it would succeed with like extremely high probability, which is good enough for algorithms, actually. Actually, there is work how to de-randomize Johnson-Lindenstrauss, but somehow, usually it's not a concern. We're okay with such a weaker guarantee. Okay, so I guess that's it for today. See you tomorrow.